Welcome back to our fourth video on the structural analysis of a modular house in Autodesk Robot. And in this video, we're going to go through the structural analysis of the frame. We're going to look at load combinations, releases, stresses, bending moment diagrams, deflections, and much more. So stay tuned, like the video, subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. Let's get into it. This is the modular house we have modeled so far. We've got columns, beams, bracings, and the panels to distribute the loads. Let's start defining the load combinations. I like doing it manually, just in case your code is not supported by robot and you can't generate it automatically. I'm going to add the type of combination to the table so we can differentiate strength and serviceability combinations. So let's start doing 1.2G plus 1.5Q, and that's for strength, and I'm just going to add the case and the factors for each combination. So 1.2G for 1.2 for the dead load and 1.5 for live load. Okay, cool. And then the second one will be for serviceability. It's pretty much G plus 0.7Q. We can assess the deflection of the structure. So it's pretty much one for the dead load and 0.7 for live load. And 0.7, that's it. And then the last one is just G plus wind. And the wind pressure we've chosen is too high for serviceability. But for training purpose, we're just going to run with that. So it's going to be just one for the dead loads, and then just one for wind load as well. Okay, cool, we're done here. Just gonna close this table, and here you can check all the load case and the combinations, and you can just turn on the load symbols and numbers so you can check if they have been applied correctly. So let's just change the load combinations here, see if anything changes. That's the dead loads plus wind loads. Just going to turn off the numbers here so we can see that the wind loads applied in the right direction, and that's pretty much it. Go to Tools, Job Preference, Structural Analysis, and make sure the DSC is turned on, and let's run the calculations. That DSC is just because we're going to use releases, and that makes the model run smoothly. It doesn't mean the model is not going to run if you don't tick that, but just in case. Okay, so I'm going to close this so I can show you how to open this tab. Go to results, diagram for bars, and let's have a look at the bending moments. On the parameters tab, you can change the diagram descriptions. Just going to change this to all. And let's analyze the top frame. So select all the members at the top and edit a new window. Okay, good. You can let's amplify the diagrams. So just go to this tab and increase a little bit the diagrams, apply. Okay, note that we have some negative bending moments at the ends and also where the supports are. Just going to change this to the load combination to 1.2G plus 1.5Q. Notice that the roof beams have negative bending moments as well. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna apply releases to the bars. So select the bar, and on the left hand side in release, we're just gonna change this to fixed paint. Okay, right click, display, and then make sure releases box is ticked on. Now we can see the paint symbol here. Let's just run the calculations. We just want to make sure that when we apply the paint release to that end of the bar, the negative moment has gone. Okay, so let's have a look. And yeah, as expected, we don't have the negative bending moment anymore. Does that mean that the negative moment disappeared? Of course not. It has been transferred to the positive moment. Okay, so you can see now that in the middle, if the bending is higher than before. The same goes with the roof beams here. I'm just gonna paint both ends of this roof beam. And I'll have to run the calculations. And now we're just gonna compare that one to the other roof beam. And we're gonna notice that the positive bending moment in one of the beam should be higher for the same reason that I just explained. Okay, so if one is 4.71 and the other one is 3.43, and we don't have negative bending moment, so it works. If you go to geometry releases, you can check the release directions and see what's happening. You know, if you have a look at this one, you've got the end, all the rotation at the end of the member released. So make sure that you check those little things in the whole model to ensure the releases have been applied properly. And obviously you gotta go through the whole model and make sure that the connections that you're designing match the releases that you're applying in the model. Another trick I find useful is to assess the stresses at the members. So you can right click, go to tables, take stresses, and then choose the global extremes tabs. And here we can view the bars with the highest stress, and you can compare that to the steel you were using. So let's suppose you're using 350 MPa. Bar 89 is already over this limit. So we can make sure the bars, the members that we're using, they're not being overstressed. So let's close this table and look for bar 89 here in the model. There it is. And let's just analyze this bar in a new window. Okay, so I want to see the bending moment for this member for a 1.2G plus 1.5Q load combination. And there we go. So this is a 125 by 75 RHS. So if you check the bending moment capacity of this section, you will probably notice that it cannot take this bending moment. So you might have to upsize this beam. That's a little trick that I like using, you know, so you can just go straight to the beams that are being overstressed. Then you check the bending moments and check that against the bending capacity in the books, or you can calculate the bending capacity and make sure they're not reaching the limits. We should also check the reactions of the supports so we can design the footings of the structure. So let's just take FX, FY, and FZ here. Take descriptions. And then apply. And then you can check all the reactions of our footings. You can also check the tables, right click, go to tables, tick reactions. There you go, reactions, and same thing, just go to the global extremes tab. That's for all load cases, all the that's the FZ for all the load combinations. So if you right click and go to filters, you can change node to case. Let's use combination G plus 0.7Q. And then we get that at node of support 15, we have 39.96 kilonewtons, which should be the highest one, so we can just design our footings for this load. Let's have a look at the deflections now. So let's just select all the upper frame and let's add it in a new window. Okay, so we've got a roof beam deflecting 19 millimeters and the other roof beam deflecting 8 millimeters. This one here forgot to change the release, so let's ping. Okay, so now we've got two roof beams that are pinned at both ends. Let's run the calculations. And what we're seeing here is the global deflection. Okay, so the beams below are deflecting, therefore the column above will deflect and the roof beam on top will deflect even more. That's why it's deflecting 21 millimeters, because you can see at the ends is deflecting 14 mil, and in the other column, in the other beam, is deflecting only 2 millimeters. What I like doing is to check the local deflection. You can select the nodes and create a roller support. So here we're just going to create a new support, and this is going to be a roller support. So I'm just going to fix the Z direction. Okay, so fix UZ. And as you can see now, we've got rollers at the four nodes. Just going to run the calculations again. And after that, you're going to see that they're going to both deflect the same amount. See, now they're deflecting 8 millimeters, and you can use this value to check your deflection limits. Okay, so usually it's span divided by 250, but this can vary depending on the structure, depending on your code. So that's the value that you're gonna use to assess the deflection limits. Okay, I'm just gonna delete this supports now. Gonna run the calculations again. Okay, cool. Let's have a look at the wind load deflection. So as I said in the beginning, these loads might be too high to check deflection. And also you can see that this house needs more bracing as well, right? But let's just run with this example. You can play around with the sections as well. So usually open sections are more economical. I'm just gonna change these floor beams to a 250 PFC. And I'm gonna also change the roof beams to a 150 UB. Let's just play around and see what happens. I'm gonna run the calculations again. You can see that the deflections have reduced the deflections for wind is still high as expected, because we didn't really increase much the bracing or the stiffness of the structure. What we can do to reduce the lateral deflection is we can portalize this end of the module, and that's going to help with deflection. So let's just make these columns 200 PFC and this beam a 200 PFC as well. And run the calculations. And we're going to see that the deflections will reduce a lot, right? There we go, 6 mil. And that's one thing that you can do to brace the structure if you can't fit any ply bracings or any sort of type of bracing. And last, we're going to check the axial force in the cross bracings. So we're going to select all the round bars, edit a new window, and as you can see, just going to amplify here the axial force. As you can see, the bracing is, the wind's blowing to the X direction, so only these round bars will have tension. And for example, you can use 18.98 to design the rods. Okay, cool. So that was it for today, guys. I usually try to work with simple 2D models, but when it comes to modular house, I prefer modeling the whole 3D frame, because I might have to design the lifting and the transportation process, so it makes easier to have the 3D model. And also sometimes the architects like changing the structure, and then it makes easy, and you just go to the model and, you know, do the adaptations. I hope you enjoyed the video. If you have any questions, just leave a comment below, and don't forget to have fun your engineering journey. I love you all, and I'll see you next time.